Hello and welcome to another episode of Looking at Picture Books. I've just had a lovely chat with Diane Ewen about the illustrations for her new book with Rashmi Sirdeshpande, Never Teach A Stegosaurus To Do Sums. So we'll have a look at that in a minute, but first I'm going to share with you a couple of other books about numbers. The first book I'm going to look at is Measuring and Recording by Jenny Taylor and Terry Ingleby. This is actually a book I picked up in a charity shop. It was published in 1963. Oh, and I see that the drawings are by Alan Jessett. It's just a really beautifully designed book about numbers and how we use them, with a very simple colour palette. I really enjoyed the simplicity of these pictures of things like spoons and milk bottles. And even maps. Even a page all about meters and the people who come to read them. And a little quiz at the end. The next one's Little One by Anne and Paul Rand, which is also from the early 60s, 1962 in fact, but this one is still in print. So it's just a very playful little story about a number and all the different things he can do when he combines with other numbers. It's a really nice graphic inky style with loose blocks of colour collaged in. Really like the cropping on this page. You know it's a cat even though you can't see its face. And here's Never Teach A Stegosaurus To Do Sums by Rashmi Sirdeshpande and Diane Ewen. Starts with the Stegosaurus as a little toy helping the girl with her homework, but then he comes to life in her imagination and they go on all sorts of mathematical adventures together, adding, taking away, and a few other sneaky tricks too. So the book is really all about the joy of learning and all the different things you can do if you understand numbers. So the two of them build this lovely egg-shaped stegosaur rocket together and off they go. There's a little lesson here about keeping trying if something goes wrong. And then they meet some aliens. A little fantasy about robots and what would happen if those robots made more robots, and things might get a teensy bit out of control, but luckily Steggy has an off button.
And hi Jane,
thank you so much for coming on Looking at Picture Books to talk about your wonderful new book, Never Teach a Stegosaurus to Do Sums. But before we start, I just wanted to say a big congratulations, because your previous book with Rashmi, Never Show a T-Rex a Book, has just won the Society of Authors Queen's Knickers Award, is that right?
Yep, that's correct. Yeah, brilliant.
That must have been a really nice feeling.
It was wonderful. It was a surprise, but a really nice surprise, and it just takes it to another level. It makes what we do worthwhile. So
exactly, yeah. And it was a prize specifically for a funny book, wasn't it? But what's great about these books is they're funny, but you really learn something and you learn to love learning. That's the kind of message.
Yeah, Rashmi's so good with these. She comes up with the ideas, and I wouldn't have thought of the idea of what would happen if you showed a T-Rex a book, or indeed what would happen if you taught a stegosaurus to do sums. It's just a sort of a way out idea, but it actually works.
Yeah.
And getting to work on them with her is, you know, it's really a pleasure. And I'm so proud of what we've achieved together so far. So
I know lots of people who haven't made a picture book think that the author and the illustrator sit in the same room next to each other and yes. do something together. And obviously I know that's not how it is, but I did wonder, because it's your second book with Rashmi, I wondered whether you had, you know, chatted about what you were going to put in the illustrations and had.
Not really. Those conversations usually go on between me and the designer, mm-hmm. Which is Claire Doughty for Puffin. But I do occasionally, when it goes back to feedback, I'll hear something that Rashmi said. And one of them, I think it was for the Steggy book, because we call it the Steggy book.
Yeah.
I did some pizza, and she wrote back and she said, "Is that pepperoni on the pizza?" And it was actually. And she said she didn't, she's because she's a vegetarian.
Yeah.
Could I take the pepperoni off and put tomato?
Oh, that is attention to detail.
Yes. And also I did some of the aliens in there. The aliens that are actually in the book are not the original, because I did one with lots of eyes in it.
Mm-hmm.
And Rashmi had something that she didn't particularly like. I don't know if it's because there are lots of circles together. So I had sort of modified. There are quite a few eyes on the aliens, but it's those types of things that that I get fed back.
Yes.
And it makes that book mine and hers.
Exactly, and you tweak it to something that you're yeah. really proud of. So yeah. do you want to tell me a little bit about the process of putting your part of the book together? So obviously you yeah. get the text, and then what's next?
Well, so I get the text, and obviously, as you know, you get a few suggestions from the designer, but obviously I can put my spin on certain things and my ideas come through. So once I've got the text, I dive straight in. I don't start at the beginning, and I don't think I ever start at the beginning, really. Obviously, I've created the character. They're happy with that. So I just play around with how it would look in different poses. So I've got that all set out in my mind and on paper. In both books, I've used textures for their bodies. And when I say textures, I use watercolour. Play around a bit, see what I like. And then I scan that into computer. So once I've done all the I don't like sketching. I was just about to say sketching, but I don't like sketching in the traditional way.
Yeah.
I won't sit and sketch out the whole book. I will sketch a bit, shore it up into a solid image, possibly in components, mm-hmm. and then I'll scan it into the computer, and then I'll manipulate, I'll add my textures, I'll add the texture that I've made, I'll put it in and I'll make it a pattern, and I'll use that to colour whatever it is I'm colouring.
Yeah. Are you using Photoshop to put all your...
Yes, I scan it up on Photoshop, because I find that once it's in there, I can do anything with it. And sometimes I even just draw directly onto the image that I'm working on rather than scanning it in. So it gives me a lot of freedom to do what I really want to do and make it my own. But I really do like adding textures into, but I feel it makes it a little bit my own.
Exactly, yeah. And it suits a book where a dinosaur is the main character.
Yeah,
Well, nobody's seen one, of course, but you'd imagine that slightly.
It's
not smooth, is it? It's got to be textured.
So it's a wide remit when it comes to actually colouring it in. As you know, as an illustrator, you know you've got that part for yourself. It's really yours. And so I try to put my design elements, my skills, my thought process, what I want really in it at that point.
One of the things I really love about this book is all the little tiny details everywhere, like the way on the opening page. So is that the T-Rex from the other
yes,
book under the
is,
table?
Yeah.
That's so nice.
The reason I think we did that is because obviously it connects us to the first book and it makes it into a series. But it's nice just to follow on to see what you've done and just include a little bit in for everyone. They might think, oh, there's a T-Rex under the table. And then you know, they'll go and find the book.
Exactly. It's a little bit of product placement.
Yeah.
I also really love, I like the way in this spread that's nearly at the end where you've got the Katherine Johnson poster.
Yeah. Yeah. A lot of people have mentioned that. And I think that was a good move to put her in, because it then a child of colour possibly is reading the book and they come across this image.
Yeah.
And, oh, who's that? And then that triggers off.
Let's find out more.
Yeah, they want to know more. And, you know, I would never, as a small child, think that I could be an illustrator, never mind a person that works with rockets and things like that.
Yeah.
So it's, as long as we can put things in that jog people's interest, and then they can go on and
find out. And believe that anything's
possible. Yeah, getting kids involved with, you know, that thought process, I can be whoever or whatever I want to do in life. It's opened. You know, it's open to me.
And just while we're talking about the details, the bookshelf on the very last page.
Oh, yes.
To ask, the book called Peter Penguin in Paris. Is that a real book?
Oh, yes. Oh, no.
Yes, it's this tiny little thing, but Peter Penguin in Paris, is that going to happen?
It sounds like a really good idea, doesn't it?
I think you should pick that one.
Yeah, that might be, I might take that back and say, Rashmi, can we have a book written about Peter?
Exactly. One of the things you sent through was some of your character development sketches for Steggy, and there are two different approaches there, and I just wondered if you'd talk a bit about the process. One of them looks a little bit younger.
After I'd done the T-Rex book, they came to me and they wanted the Steggy book, and they stipulated it's got to be a young Steggy. I think the T-Rex one probably, I would say, is an older character, but not too old. What I usually do if I'm in a block is I get everything down on paper. At that particular time, the younger version, that's what I was thinking at the moment, so I did that. And usually when I do that, it triggers off other things. So I'll do that and I'll look at it and I'll think, well, perhaps this is not the right age group, or perhaps a bit too young, or perhaps it's a bit too old. Mm-hmm. And then I do another set of illustrations, character development, and then I see, does that fit? Does that fit what they're asking of the character? Would that character be able to, do you know when they're sitting around, like an Inspector Clouseau in one of the...
Yes, with the disguises on, yeah.
I think the first set that I did was possibly a bit too young for that. So that's how I do. And then I'll probably do loads of them, but it's just trial and error at that stage when I'm designing the character. It'll just sit on the page and I'll know that's the one that I feel will carry this book.
I was going to ask about the colour choices, because it's a lovely, vibrant, enticing book. And obviously nobody knows what colour a Stegosaurus actually was.
Yeah.
So how do you arrive at the colour choices, both for that character and for the book as a whole?
I don't know whether I saw blue Stegosaurus. I don't know, but I had that colour in mind before I even started. He was going to be blue. The shade of blue, possibly, you know, we could play around with, but he was going to be blue. So that was never in doubt for me. And having said so, it created a few problems.
Right.
Because once you put that main colour down and you do things like, okay, I've got a blue for the main body. I've got to do, what do you call them? I call them humps on the back. The stegs on the...
The stegs, yeah.
Yeah, stegs. And I thought, what goes with blue? So I thought it'd be a perfect combination to have like a contrasting colour. Mm-hmm. And once I'd said that, I didn't move, because the stegs could have been any colour. Because I definitely wanted the blue on. And that was a choice I'd made, you know, at the very beginning. I did have, I don't know if you noticed the one with the aliens. That's the one that gave me the most trouble, I think, in terms of the colour coordination.
Planet is orange.
Yeah.
You want the orange against the orange.
So I had to think, how can I break this up? How can I get this to stand without, you know, disappearing into the background? And so happens that, you know, this superb...
Yeah, I love the egg-shaped rocket.
Yeah, rocket was there. So that sort of dug me out of a deep hole.
Yes, that's a good little illustrator trick there.
Yeah. So, it's that type of thing that you have to work with as an illustrator. You have to think, yeah, I've made a choice. I know what I want. But then things come along down the road that sort of try and get in your way, but you have to see your way around it.
You do. It's all about problem solving, really, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. But then that makes it more you look at the spread, it's worked, and you love it, and you think, well, it took me a long time to get up, but I really like that.
Yes.
You know what I mean? So it's worth the hard work, it's worth the sleepless nights, it's worth doing it over and over again.
Yeah. It's one of those moments where you think, oh, how am I gonna sort this out?
Yeah, exactly. It's really been an extraordinary book to work on, not simply because of the story, but because of having to obviously design that character that stands up and stands alone and is recognisable. I think that's, you know, when you draw a character, you think, I've got to make this character, I don't know if the word's special, but that it stands out against all the other books that are on the shelf.
Yes.
And because there are an awful lot of books on the shelf, which are brilliant. So it's a fight, is that, you know, it's a sort of battle to be seen,
yep,
in a crowd.
Yes.
So hopefully we've done that with this book and with his character. Yeah. So I'm quite pleased.
The whole concept of it, I did what, I mean, you probably can't say, but I wonder if there's anything else in the pipeline. If you can't say, that's okay.
I can hint.
Sorry?
I can hint to the affirmative.
Good. I'm glad to hear that.
I think it'd be a shame not to do more books with Rashmi, because I think she has a really good knack of, you know, coming up with good ideas, and she's a good writer.
Yes.
You know, once you've found someone that you can, you know, that you work well with, it's hard to let them go.
Like a really natural partnership. And speaking of partnerships, I can't let you go without asking about your role in Hey You, which I don't know if you've seen the video I made with Dapo about that book.
I did, yeah, it was really good. I really liked it.
Part of that amazing project. How did that feel?
Yeah, that was out of the blue. I got a DM on Twitter from Dapo, just saying, you know, he's going to do this project. And he'd be interested to know if I would be interested to be part of it.
Yeah.
And I didn't really think about it. I just said yes, because obviously Dapo is, you know, the person that is at the moment. And then I got my email to ask me, you know, formally to do it. But it was a no-brainer. I was going to do it anyway. And then I found out about what it was. Obviously, that just reassured me that I, you know, I'd made the right decision. And I'm so pleased about how it's turned out. And the other illustrators are so fantastic.
Yes.
Even, I look through it now, the book, and I'm reading all the stuff that Dapo's written, and I agree with it totally. And then I look at the illustrations, and there's always something new to look at. And it's so nice to have so many different perspectives and to see so many people of colour that I didn't know existed. Because when I was trying to be an illustrator, I knew that I wanted to make, you know, diverse children a bit more prominent in the books that we were reading. But I didn't know that that dream was ever, you know, we had so many other illustrators had the same dream. And I think Dapo's allowed us to interact together now and to know each other and to know that we're not alone in this struggle. So from that point of view, Hey You is a brilliant vehicle for us, but also for kids. Getting that book at a young age is, you know, it's ever a revelation, and it'll be opening up the world for them, and their thought processes will change. They will think that they will know that they have a voice and they have a place, and that they can achieve whatever it is that they want to, you know, try to achieve on many, many levels. I think that book is so fantastic.
But you're part of it.
I just see it going stratospheric, you know, if it's not already.
Oh, definitely. Totally.
Yeah. it's gonna resonate with a lot of people. So, you know, all the good to that. Yeah, the books are there, and I think people should go and buy them.
I like that. Yes, they should.
Okay.
So thank you so much, Diane, for telling us all about the process behind this lovely new book.
My pleasure.
I'm going to end with a quote from Show Me a Story. And this is from the introduction to the book. The introduction by David Wiesner. Picture books tell stories in a visual language that is rich and multi-levelled, sophisticated in its workings despite its often deceptively simple appearance. It is through the book's images that the child first understands the world of the story, where it's set, when it takes place, whether it's familiar or new. They read the characters' emotions and interactions in facial expressions and body language. They may notice secondary pictorial storylines happening alongside the main action, like a secret for them to follow. And nowhere is visual humour explored more fully than in the picture book. I'll see you next time on Looking at Picture Books. If you enjoyed the video, don't forget to subscribe to my channel so you don't miss all the exciting episodes I've got coming up.